So right. Can you feel the presence of God? Let me open this. Do you want to open this up, or do you mind if I open this up, this question?
No, you can go for it. Sure.
Okay, so one way I like to phrase this is William Lane Craig, for example, is a very famous Christian debater, and he says for him personally, that's the reason why he believes in God, is because he knows God is real, because he has a personal relationship. And it's not appropriate to bring that into a debate, so he doesn't bring that into debates, you know, as far as evidence for God, but he is saying that for himself personally, that is a major reason. And, you know, like I said early at the start of the show, when I was a Christian, I really felt like I had a relationship with God. I felt like there was a love relationship there. I felt like I was being led by the Spirit. I felt like I was getting answers from prayer. I could pray to God. I felt like the Bible was touching me when I was reading parts of it. So I know those feelings, but for me, I studied science and philosophy, and I thought, well, it has to be a delusion, just like there's a mirage in a desert's a delusion. So that's my take on it, and that is very important because, like I said, logical fallacies, you cannot determine truth by feelings. Right. And some people who think they can, they manipulate people by this. Like, for example, if there's a murderer on trial, you know, he'll put on a nice suit, and people are like, well, that guy can't be guilty. He looks so nice. Like, what a nice guy. He's a handsome guy. He can't be a murderer. But, you know, you can't determine the truth of something by your feelings. So what would you have to say about all that?
So I agree 100% that I think that is one of the huge errors that's made in the church today. And I'd say a lot of youth pastors do that often, that there is a lot of emotional manipulation, that it's not, feelings are not a test for truth, that you can have all kinds of feelings that are false. I mean, I got to the point where after I was a born-again Christian, I got to the point where I felt that it was false, and I thought that it was false. I've had all kinds of feelings that ended up not being true. And I've heard you point out before, you know, Mormons will make the same argument that people of other religions would say that they feel their religion is true. So if I feel Christianity is true and the Muslim feels Islam is true, I can't say, well, feel what I feel. There's got to be something outside of both of us that we can both appeal to in order to judge whose truth claims really are true. So I would say what's happening for somebody who's a Christian is their feelings are simply their emotional response to what they believe is true, and they're confusing the feelings to what they are actually believing is true.
Yeah, let me give you an example of that. One time I was going to work, and I was in the cafeteria, and I thought, you know what? I just feel really good. I feel like I'm bubbling with love. I feel like I'm in love with God. I don't have any pains in my body anywhere. I just feel really good. It must be because of God, because I'm praying to God. I'm always thinking about God. I'm praying, you know, I'm thinking and praying about God as I'm walking and everything. And then I thought, wait a minute, did I do anything different today? I don't think so, but just let me go through this exercise. You know, that's kind of what I thought. And so after I thought for about 30 seconds, I thought, yeah, you know what? I took 2 ibuprofens. And because I don't know, I was having a headache or something, but 2 ibuprofens. And it's like, oh, interesting. So I was conflating that good feeling with God and everything because, you know, I'm praying and everything with God. So I conflated those two real easily.
Right. And you know what? I would say the church is guilty of that. And I think that what you're saying right there is a good reason that every youth pastor needs to hear this, that they can't do that. They cannot try to appeal to feelings because it just doesn't work. But you got to have reasons for what you believe. Absolutely. And that's what I would say, that you know, the position I come from, how do we know God exists? The test for truth is not going to be your feelings. Your feelings are just your reaction to what you think is truth.
But you know that
your feelings what about motivate this, you to do something.
But what about this argument that, you know, you have this God-shaped hole in your heart? Everybody has this hole that they want to get filled in. It's basically, you know, getting filled in with a relationship with God, they're saying.
Yeah, well, that could be talking about more like a need for purpose and meaning, which I would say that could actually be rational. That doesn't have to be a feeling. It doesn't have to be, I have this emotional need. It can be that I do have a need for purpose and meaning. That would be, I think, different.
So how do you, you know, let me give you one more illustration of this, too. When I was a Christian, you know, there's this thing that passed around on email. They have these inspirational stories, and there's this one where this, you know, atheist professor's talking and he's putting down God, and the guy in the audience asks a question. He's an old man in the back of the room, and he eats an apple, and he says, tell me, sir, is this apple sweet? And he goes, I have no idea what that apple tastes like. And he goes, neither do you know how my Savior tastes, you know, sir. And so it was basically the idea that this is my personal experience and you have no idea.
Which is subjectivism. I would say, yes, I've definitely experienced a transformation in my life. That suddenly my values changed, my goals changed, my desires changed, that there is that happened. But you do need reason in order to be able to frame your experience, to be able to explain your experience, that once you start getting into just pure intuition and feelings, that's where a lot of Christians would say, you know, that's when heresy starts, when false doctrine starts. When you start, instead of using reason, you start using your feelings and your intuition.
Well, what do you think of this one? I debated this one Christian professor one time, and he said that basically he knows God exists because it's, you know, it's a relationship. He goes, it's like I know my wife exists. I have a relationship. That's the exact example he used. It's like, I know my wife exists. That's how I know God exists.
Yeah, well, I would say the relationship we have with God is very different from people. That God, there's an unseen providential hand that after analyzing our lives, we can see that we are being moved to certain end goals, that when I go through joy and suffering, evil and good, all these things are actually moving me towards perfection, that there's goodness that comes to me through that. In that sense, we have a relationship with God, that we see him moving providentially in our lives. Maybe that's what the guy meant.
Well, so how about you personally? Do you feel like you have a relationship with God, like you feel the love of God, that God directs your paths, like you can pray to God for answers and God will actually tell you answers and actually guide you?
In general, yes. I mean, I don't know about what you mean by feel. Like, again, I don't think God works in my feelings. Again, I think my feelings are just my reaction to what I think is true. That love is not, you know, a feeling. That I'm convinced that God does love me and that is working in my life. And I do pray, and I think a lot of Christians pray the wrong thing. That if you always pray, God, let me never die, that prayer eventually is not going to be answered. But there are some things that, you know, you're going to get sick, and there's going to be some time when you don't get healed. And I think a lot of people end up questioning God when they don't get exactly what they want. But God doesn't promise us a yes to those kind of questions. The kind of questions he promises yes to would be something like, God, I want to know you more. I want to be good. Help me become good. And I want to be used by you. Like if you read in the Psalms, you don't see David praying things like, God, let let my cat not die. Kind of things that, like, you know, a lot of American high school Christians may want to pray for.
Well, they do pray for war, or like David prayed that his kid wouldn't die, and I mean, there's...
And it didn't come true. In 2 Samuel, his son died.
Mm-hmm. But those are things people pray for, whatever's really important in their life, I guess.
Yeah, but there's certain things we don't get a promise to a yes, certain other things we do.
Do you feel like God talks to you? And how so, if he does?
I would say God does communicate to me through experiences that I go through me reflecting on what I learned through my experiences, and of course through the special revelation through the Word of God, the written revelation of God.
So is it kind of like always looking for signs kind of thing? Like God's trying to give you a sign here and there, and you're trying to follow the signs?
I would say not to look for signs. In fact, Deuteronomy 18 says, do not live by interpreting omens. The Bible actually teaches not to do that. A lot of Christians will do that, kind of like, if you want me to marry my girlfriend, God, then let it rain today, that kind of thing. It's actually forbidden in Scripture to have those kind of signs.
Yeah, okay.
So we reason is what God wants us to use to make decisions.
Okay, I'll give you 15 seconds to summarize on this.
Well, we can move on so we get more time to the next topic.
Okay, let's move on.